There's power. There's power in the mighty name of Jesus. And every war he wages, he will win. So I'm not backing down from any giant. I know how this story ends. Well, I know how this story. What the enemy meant for evil. Come on. You take what the enemy meant for evil and you turn it for good. You turn it for good. You take what the enemy meant for evil and you turn it for good. You turn it.
I learned to trust him.
just Jesus, Savior, friend. And I know that He is with me, will be with me till the end. Jesus, Jesus, how I trust Him, how I prove Him more and more. Jesus, Jesus, precious Jesus, oh, for grace to trust Him more. One more time. Heavenly Father, thank You that we can trust You. Thank You for Your power in our lives. Thank You that though the enemy roams about this earth seeking to steal and kill and destroy, that, Lord, greater is Your love, greater is Your power, greater are You in us than all the powers of evil, God. We're thankful for that kind of power in our lives, and we celebrate, we magnify, we glorify, and we worship You today for Your goodness and strength and Your truth in our lives. And it's in the holy and matchless name of Jesus that we pray all these things. Amen.
Good stuff. So I was talking to somebody earlier before the service started, and we were talking about, you know, growing up and being forced to come to church, you know, every Sunday. Right. I mean, there were no, of course, my dad was a pastor, so I really didn't have a choice. But, you know, every Sunday we would go, and, you know, and when you're a kid, that's the stuff you sing. You know, it's the hymns. And, you know, every Sunday I went. And, of course, you know, when you get into your, you know, junior high or teenage years, you're like, Dad, do I have to go? But, you know, I am so thankful that my parents made me go every Sunday, because I learned beautiful hymns like that. And so when I sing those things, boy, it takes me back to my childhood and wonderful time. How many of you were forced to go to church when you were kids? See? Did you good, didn't it? Amen. All right. So listen, I want you to know that on days like today, when it's pouring outside and you go to church, there are special crowns in heaven for you for days like today. So I just want to, okay, thank you for braving all that tough weather out there. All right. We have a special Sunday today. We're going to do something completely different. Now, I know that none of you get tired of hearing me talk up here, right? But every once in a while, we like to change it up and do something different, and we're going to do that this morning. We have a special friend with us today. He is a minister of magic and premiered all throughout Moscow, Russia. And he has flown into the United States today to be with us at Living Stone. Pretty cool. So, I want you to give a warm welcome to our friend. He was here back in November of 2019. Did any of you see him here? He was awesome. So we asked him to come back, and he graciously decided to come back. And so, I want to introduce to you our friend, Victor Zenko.
How are you? Good. Thank you, sir. Oh, the music is perfect. Задумывался ли ты когда-нибудь о том, какой он единый Бог? Единый Бог – это Дух, и его нет тела, как у тебя и у меня. И хотя ты не можешь видеть Бога, он находится повсюду. Today, I am going to deceive you, because I am what some people might call a trickster, a cheat, a fraud. But you can trust me. You can trust me, because I am an honest liar. No, no, it's true. Think about it. When the crook, the con man, the swindler, when they attempt to rob you, they want to steal from you not only your money, but your dignity as well. Not me. Today, I deceive you with your permission. Maybe everybody else will catch up with that laughter. It's okay. So my advice for you today is this. Believe none of what you see and only half of what you hear. Or believe none of what you hear and only half of what you see. But whichever you choose, I do sincerely hope that you will thoroughly enjoy the deceptions of this honest liar. But first, my bona fides, to prove to you that I am really who I claim to be. Young man, way in the back, yes, can you come forward? They will applaud for you. Yes. I asked this guy because I am so jealous of his hair. Come forward. You are? Jet, nice to meet you. I should have known you got here really fast. Okay, good. Okay, Jet, I have to tell you in the audience a very important story. The first recorded card trick in all of history was given to us by the 16th century scientist and mathematician Girolamo Cardano, all right? And his account comes this way. He claims that he was visiting the Holy Roman Emperor, Charles V, at his court in Milan. They were friends. And one evening while there, they were mesmerized by the performance of a traveling Spanish magician. There was one feat that this magician did that was so incredible, so mind-blowing, so impossible, that Cardano says he doubted his own senses and his own sanity. Since then, magicians, great and small, have attempted to achieve this feat, to recreate it. It has become known in the magic profession as the Cardano effect. But no magician, no matter how great, how talented, how accomplished, has ever been able to do it. In fact, most modern magicians believe that Cardano's account was pure fiction, fantasy. Can't be done. Impossible. Until today. Ladies and gentlemen, the long sought after but never before achieved Cardano effect. All right, Mr. Jet. First, please verify for the audience that the cards are different. They're all mixed up. Perfect. Okay. You know how to do cut, right? You cut a chunk off the top, you move it to the bottom. All right? The interesting thing is every time you do that, a different card ends up on top. All right? Take the deck of cards. I'm not going to look, so I don't know exactly where you cut. Mr. Jet, cut the cards. Let me know when they are cut. Okay, listen carefully. You can leave the cards there, or you can cut one more time. What would you like to do? Oh, he's going to cut again. Okay, so this changes the card again. Good. Mr. Jet, one last time. You can stay where you are, or you can cut once more. He's going to stay. Okay, listen to me carefully. The top card. I don't want you to look at it yet. I just want you to take it and hold it over your heart so nobody can see it. Have you done that? Okay, now just peek at it and memorize it. Do you have it? It's committed to memory. Okay, listen carefully. Take that card and I want you to slide it back into the deck somewhere around the middle. And let me know when it is there. Okay, now I did not see what he did, but I heard. First part of the Cardano effect. Don't do anything, but Mr. Jet, you have placed your card back into the deck at exactly the 28th position. So your card is now 28 cards from the top. Don't ask me how I know that. I just know it. All right? Okay, Mr. Jets, here's what I want you to do. You're going to deal cards face up. You're going to deal 27 cards face up. So don't deal the 28th card yet. Okay, so go ahead. Face up, perfect, keep going, count out loud. Stop right there. Okay, so the next card is the 28th. Now, this is what I want you to do. I'm not looking at you. I didn't see you deal the cards down. I want you to get a clear picture in your mind of your card. Visualize it. And I know this sounds strange, but the best that you can, push that image from your mind into my mind. Okay, I'm going to make some commentary about your card, Mr. Jet, but I don't want you to say if I'm right or wrong, okay? No hints, no clues, but I am seeing red and white. So I know it's not a black card. I also know it's not a king, queen, or jack, because then I would see a whole mixture of colors. Mr. Jet, in your mind, almost like a movie camera, move up to the top left corner and zoom in a little bit. Good, 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 good. Okay, I clearly see a single digit. So I know it's not a 10. It's still a little blurry. It's coming in and out of focus. Excellent, excellent. Okay, Mr. Jet, in a loud, clear voice, I want you to say yes or no. That's it, okay? You cut the cards. You took the card you wanted. You put it back into the deck. I have not touched or controlled the cards at all. I've not seen what you have done. And yet, to achieve the first part of the Cardano effect, the card that you are now thinking of is the Five of Diamonds. All right, again, the next card is the 28th card. Mr. Jet, don't look at the card. Just, again, take it from the top. Hold it over your heart. Okay? If this card is the 28th card, then I will have successfully achieved the Cardano effect. Mr. Jet, look at the card and then show the audience. Thank you, sir. Fantastic. Applause for my friend. By the way, we did not set that up. You are free to ask him later. Is that true, Mr. Jet? I'll do the jokes. All right. Very good. Very good. Okay. So, ladies and gentlemen, did you enjoy the Cardano effect? It's really quite difficult. And the only reason I say that it usually garners more applause. But that's okay. You know, to each his own. Okay. Now, I have to be honest with you. I think we have a little bit of a misunderstanding. Okay? A misunderstanding is an accidental miscommunication, right? But there are also misunderstandings which are misunderstandings on purpose. And those are called deception. So, me pretending to be the Russian magician Viktor Zenko is a misunderstanding on purpose. I am but a lowly actor who knows his way around a deck of cards. Let me give you another example. By the way, my name is Bruce. You want to know my name? I have such a white bread name. My name is Bruce Johnson. So I am not Russian. I'm actually of Scottish descent. So it's a crazy story. But let me give you another example of a misunderstanding on purpose. All right? Can you help me for a moment? Would you? I didn't wake you up, did I? No. Can you just come right up these stairs? Everybody will welcome you here. And you are?
Diana.
So nice to meet you, Diana. Diana, can you come stand right over here? Oh, wow. It's the Diana show, everybody. Here we go. Okay, Diana. No, right on the trap door. There you go. Very good. Okay, Diana, I need you to help me with something just for a moment to demonstrate a misunderstanding on purpose. All right? Now, is the bag empty? Oh, she comes right in. Okay, good, good, good. Okay, good. Now, I'm going to take the egg and place it inside the bag. My empty hand. I'm going to put my hand inside. Now, what I want you to do in a moment is verify for everybody that the egg is still there. Okay? Not yet. In a moment. Very eager, Diane. Okay, here we go. Let me do it with the other hand. Excellent. Okay. So, don't press too hard, but it's right there. Correct? Okay, good. Touch. Wait a minute. I'm going to let you check again. You don't see it, do you?
Nope.
Go ahead. Feel right. Run inside. There's nothing there, right? Okay. What I want you to do, Diane, pretend to grab an egg out of the air, invisible egg. There you go. Throw it up into the air. Okay. Reach in. Diane, you're fantastic. Thank you very much. Be very careful going back. Please welcome her back to the audience. All right. Oh, Diane, can you come back for another moment? I'm sorry. I just had a brainstorm. Come right back. We're going to use another deck of cards. You're welcome to shuffle it if you like. Oh. Sudden gust of gravity. Nothing to worry about. Kind of strong over here and near the beach. Okay. She's really good at it, too. Okay. You've done this before, right, Diane? Okay. That was very kind of you. Thanks for picking those up. I appreciate it. Okay, they are shuffled now. Okay. She's a little skeptical. Okay. Oh, card shark. Okay, they're mixed up. Okay, here's what I want you to do. Diane, you're going to cut the cards anywhere you want. I don't care. Then you're going to put the cards behind your back. You're going to take the top card, the one that you've cut to. In this case, it would be the Queen of Hearts. And you're going to flip it upside down so it's going the opposite direction of all the cards and just stick it somewhere back inside the deck, okay? So cut the deck, and then take the top card, flip it over, stick it back inside the deck. Okay. Perfect. Let's put it back in the box. Okay, so nobody knows what card is face down. Thank you again, Diane. I appreciate it. Please. Okay, we're going to get back to that. Excellent. Okay, so all sleight of hand and illusion is based on purposeful misunderstandings, which again is the definition of deception. Now, you know that I don't have magic powers. You know that the egg didn't really disappear or it didn't turn invisible. But if I'm doing my job as a stage magician well, then I have effectively created a purposeful misunderstanding about where the egg is at certain times. And you're not angry with me about that. At least I hope not, right? Because we kind of have a social contract. We're both in on it, so to speak. You know, as a stage magician, when I get up to do a trick, I'm going to try to deceive you. But it's for entertainment purposes only. It's the same thing when you go to a play or a movie, right? Well, you don't come out of Braveheart and
You're angry at Mel Gibson because he's not really William Wallace, right? He hasn't really gone to battle. In the theater, we call it suspension of disbelief. You go to a play, you know the scenery's not real, you know nobody dies in the sword fight, but you're willing to go along with it to absorb the story. But there are some misunderstandings that are deadly. There are some misunderstandings that can have life-altering consequences, even eternal consequences. Now, I am totally convinced that the most important question in all of human history is, who is Jesus? Because depending on who he is, or rather if he is the person he claims to be, then that changes everything. It changes why we're here. It changes where we're going. It changes everything fundamentally about how we invest our time, our talent, our treasure. And sadly, a lot of people will investigate what kind of car they should buy or what kind of microwave oven they should buy. They'll spend more time researching that than where they might spend eternity. So it's vital that we don't misunderstand who Jesus is and that we don't allow anybody to deceive us about who Jesus is. As you know, many people in Israel at the time of Jesus misunderstood who he was. In fact, there's a conversation. In fact, I think Chris used this 2 or 3 weeks ago. Could I have that Matthew 16 passage up? When Jesus came to the region of Caesarea Philippi, he asked his disciples, "Who do the people say the Son of Man is?" Please remember this title, Son of Man, that Jesus used this title. They replied, "Some say John the Baptist, others say Elijah, and still others Jeremiah, one of the prophets." There are all these different ideas and opinions about who Jesus is in his own time. But then Jesus turns it on the disciples. He focuses in. He says, "But what about you?" He asked, "Who do you say I am?" Simon Peter, he answers for the whole group, right? "You are the Messiah, the Son of the living God." And Jesus says, "Peter, you've made a big mistake. I'm just a good teacher. I'm just trying to point people in the general direction." No, that's not what he says, is it? He says, Jesus replied, "Blessed are you, Simon, son of Jonah, for this was not revealed to you by flesh and blood, but by my Father in heaven." Jesus says to Peter, "You get it." Now, Peter might not have fully gotten it at that point, but on this particular topic, he got it. What was the title that Jesus used for himself there? Son of Man. Okay, it's Jesus' favorite title for himself. It's his favorite form of self-reference. I think I have my numbers correct, but the New Testament uses the term Son of Man 88 times. 87 of those times, it's Jesus referring to himself. Now, I want to be really honest with you. For most of my Christian life, I thought the term Son of Man was a reference completely and fully to the fact that Jesus was human. Right? Son of God refers to his deity. Son of Man refers to his humanity. But when I understood what that title, Son of Man, really meant, it totally changed the way that I read the Gospels. The Gospels kind of came alive in a new way. Now, whenever Jesus speaks, he is usually referencing the Old Testament or illuminating the Old Testament. So what Old Testament passage does Jesus use when he references himself as the Son of Man? And what passage does he use more than any other? I would suggest it's Daniel chapter 7. Can we have that? We're just going to look at verses 13 and 14. So Daniel is having a vision, a God-given vision. And he said, "In my vision at night, I looked, and there before me was one like a son of man, like a human being. coming with the clouds of heaven. Now, riding the clouds of heaven is an Old Testament motif for Yahweh. I believe it's there five times in the Old Testament. Four of those times, it's specifically referencing Yahweh. The fifth time is right here. One like a son of man coming with the clouds of heaven. He approached the Ancient of Days. So God the Father is there and was led into his presence. Daniel probably is freaking out at this point. This does not make sense to him, I would guess. He sees two Yahweh figures, the Ancient of Days and the Son of Man. Now, I'm not saying there are two gods. It's one God. But, whoa. And this is what it says about the Son of Man. He was given authority, glory, and sovereign power. All nations and peoples of every language worshiped him. Especially to a Jew, to us as well, but especially to a Jew, only God receives worship. His dominion, the Son of Man, is an everlasting dominion that will not pass away, and his kingdom is one that will never be destroyed. Wow. This is what Jesus is saying. Every time he uses the title Son of Man, he's saying, I am the Daniel 7 figure. Son of Man is not just a reference to humanity, it's a reference to Yahweh in human form. Fully God, fully man. That's exciting. Please don't let anybody ever tell you that Jesus never claims to be God. I've talked with quite a few Muslims when I was in campus ministry in Maine, and that is an apologetic they like to use. Show me the scripture that says, I am God. Well, anytime he says the Son of Man, and he's referring to himself, he's claiming deity. He's claiming to be Yahweh. It's amazing. So it's not, I want to read this quote. This is a quote from a prominent Bible scholar. I love the way he puts this. He's talking about Daniel seeing these two Yahweh figures. Listen to how academic this is. Quote, this freaked the rabbis out. Because in the intertestamental period, they knew their Hebrew Bible really well. And they know that this is a description of deity. But now this description of deity is applied to this human being. It's confusing for them. So it's not at all surprising that Jesus suffers the full fury of the Jewish religious leaders when he claims in their presence to be the Son of Man. We have that verse in Matthew 26. So this is Jesus on trial in front of the Sanhedrin. But Jesus remained silent. And the high priest said to him, we are there. I charge you under oath by the living God, tell us if you are the Messiah, the Son of God. You have said so, Jesus replied. But I say to all of you, from now on, you will see the Son of Man sitting at the right hand of the Mighty One and coming on the clouds of heaven. Jesus is not being elusive. He's not being foxy. He's not being evasive. He's telling them exactly. They knew Daniel 7. They knew exactly what he was saying. This is proof that they did know what he was saying. Then the high priest tore his clothes and said, he has spoken blasphemy. Why do we need any more witnesses? Look, now you have heard the blasphemy. What do you think? Is he worthy of? He is worthy of death, they answered. The Son of Man. Wow, it's really exciting. So again, please don't let anybody ever tell you that Jesus never claimed to be God. But what should we do with this claim? Well, a lot of people just like to try to ignore it, to explain it away, to misunderstand it on purpose. But if you ignore it, you're deciding not to make a decision, which in the end is a decision. I suggest that if you haven't done so already, you evaluate it. Concerning Jesus' claim to be God, the brilliant C.S. Lewis said, there's three options, logically, three options. One, he's a liar. He's just lying about being the Son of God. And if he's lying, he's a terrible, evil person because he says that the way you respond to me will affect your eternal destiny. And that washes away the good teacher argument. What good teacher would lie in such an evil way? Lewis says the second is he's delusional. He just thinks he's God, right? I mean, you can go to any major city. We could go to downtown St. Augustine. I'm sure we could find someone on the street who thinks that they're Jesus Christ. He just thinks he's God. But what takes care of those first two options for me is you look at Jesus. You look at his actions. You look at his wisdom. Even people who are not believers in Jesus will tell you that there has been no higher moral teaching in the last 2,000 years than the teaching of Jesus. Don't think it emanates from a crazy person. And Lewis says, you've got one option left. That he's really who he claimed to be. Personally, after evaluating the claims of Jesus, I became fully convinced that he was who he said he was. And so I said a simple prayer, surrendering my life to him, control of my life over to him. I received his offer of forgiveness for my sins based on his death on the cross to pay for those sins. And I also received his gift of eternal life, which is guaranteed to me by his resurrection from the dead. I'd like to think of the cross as a check, that Jesus is writing a check for all of our sin. But anybody could do that. I could write a check to you today for $1 million. It'll bounce higher than this ceiling. But I could do it. So the cross is Jesus writing a check for our sins, but the resurrection is the proof that the check cleared the bank, right? That he had enough in his account to pay for our sins. It's really exciting. So if you have not yet evaluated the claims of Jesus, then I encourage you to do so. People here will help you. One of our roles as the people of God, as a church, and as the church, is through our words and through our actions, is to help people clear up misunderstandings about Jesus and expose deceptions about Jesus. And that's got to start in-house. That's why I'm so thankful for Chris. He's such a great Bible teacher. It's accurate. He helps us by the Spirit of God, by his gifting, to clear up misunderstandings about God and about Jesus and to expose deception. Before I close in prayer, and I do one more little bit of illusion for you, are there any questions? I always like to do Q&A. I think we have time, don't we? I'm good on time, I think. Anything? Yes, Danny. We're good on time, but not a question. Okay. That's great, because people usually say, how do you do it? And I say, can you keep a secret? And they say, yes, of course. And I say, so can I. I have to. Okay. So, Diana graciously shuffled the cards, dropped the cards, picked them back up, put the cards behind her back, took one card, placed it face down in the deck, and we put it back in the box. I did not see which card she placed, okay? Can you help me? You can stay right there. You just stand up. What's your name? Christy, have we ever met before? No, tell the truth. We've met before, but we didn't set anything up, right? I didn't ask you to... That will be good news to my wife of 33 years. Just get that out of the way right up front. Okay, good. Okay, now, you're going to do the magic, Christy. You, not me. And you're going to work with Diane. Diane's done her part. She's randomly taken a card. She didn't look at it. She put it face down in the deck. I want you to try to envision what that card is. What card do you think she placed face down in the deck? Trust yourself, okay? Go with your intuition. Let's start with this. Is it red or black? It's a red card. Is it a heart or a diamond? Heart. Is it ace through 10 or is it a jack, queen, or king? It's your choice. It's what you're in control here, whatever you say. You can get help from this nice young man next to you, who I assume you are dating. It's an ace through 10. Great. We've narrowed it down. So no jack, queen, or king. What card is it, ace through 10? It's the what? Did you say eight? It's an eight. You were thinking of eight too? I don't know. That is really crazy. You can sit down, Christy. Thank you so much. That is so crazy. It's crazy. You were both thinking of the same thing. That's amazing. Okay. We'll look for the card, Diane. I don't know exactly where you put it, but I know you put it in here somewhere. I don't see it yet. These are green-backed cards, so. Oh, there it is right there. Okay. You took the deck, shuffled, put it behind your back, put a card face down. You were thinking of the Eight of Hearts eventually, and you were thinking of the Eight of Hearts right away. The card that Diane placed face down the Eight of Hearts. I did not do that. Give them a round of applause. Wow. Now, once again, everything happening up here is just an illusion. It's a misunderstanding on purpose, right? But if I do it well, it looks like magic. Okay. Let's close in prayer. Father in heaven, thank you so much that you love us with an everlasting love, a love that we cannot begin to comprehend, but that we believe in, that we've seen, that we've experienced, that we also read about. Father, we have so many misunderstandings about you. We have so many misunderstandings about Jesus, and there are people in the world who want to deceive us about who Jesus is. Thank you for the gifted teachers you give us. Please, God, let us spend time in your word and in prayer so that we might have a clearer and clearer picture of who you are and then a better idea of what you want us to do. We give thanks and we pray in the name of the Son of Man, Jesus the Christ. Amen.
Sing with us again. You take what the enemy meant for evil. Let's sing it.
You take what the enemy meant for evil and you turn it for good. You turn it for good. You take what the enemy meant for evil and you turn it for good. You turn it for good. And I'm gonna see a victory. I'm gonna see a victory. For the battle belongs to you, Lord. I'm gonna see a victory. I'm gonna see a victory. For the battle belongs to you, Lord.
Sing that again.
I'm gonna see a victory. I'm gonna see a victory. For the battle belongs to you, Lord. I'm gonna see a victory. I'm gonna see a For the battle belongs to you, Lord.
Awesome. Well done. Thank you. I don't know if you know it, that Bruce is actually part of our church. He's a member of our church, and he comes here regularly. And so what he'll do is he plays the part of Victor Zanko and does illusion acts around the town and the state. I think for a while he was doing a show regularly on Sundays at the Rain Tree, but I think COVID stopped all that. So it's great to have him. Great people, he and Liz. So thanks, guys. Also, if you are, if you're new to Livingstone Church and you have not filled out a visitor's card yet, we have visitor's cards on the back table. You can fill one of those out, put it in the offering box. We can know you've been here. Or you can do it the cool way and text Livingstones to 84576, and that'll bring you into our communications platform, and you can register there. Also, we have small groups that are meeting regularly during the week, and it is a great way to get to know people. Build relationships and friendships, and then get that boost of edification during the week. So I recommend you find one. There's a list of them on the back table. Also, youth group at here is here at 6 o'clock on Wednesday night, so bring your kids here. And then we do not pass a plate here at Livingstone Church. The offering boxes are in the back if you wish to honor God with your tithes and offerings. Many of you are doing it online. And it's easy and convenient. There are instructions on the back table. You can click it, take a picture with your phone, and you can do it that way. Thank you for being here. God is good. And all the time. God bless.